Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Ashhadu la ilaha illallah wa la sharika lah. Ashhadu anna Muhammadan abduhu wa rasuluhu. Wa salatu wa salamu ala sayyidina Muhammad rasulillahi kareem. Nasta'inuhu wa nastaghfiruhu wa nu'minu bihi al-malik abduhu az wa jal. I greet you with the greetings of the people of faith. Assalamu alaikum. We, with Allah's name, the merciful benefactor, the merciful redeemer. He's also the guardian evolver for his creation. We worship none but him. We don't recognize a pantheon. We don't recognize that there are more than one God. We only recognize Allah the Most High. And we don't associate with him anything in his created realm. We don't associate Jesus as being God. We associate Jesus as being the servant, the word of God, and a perfect servant of God. We don't associate Muhammad the prophet, the prayer, the peace be upon him, as being part of the divine reality. With nothing that exists in this created world is part of the Almighty God, and what we call the sub-circles of Godhead, the deity. We know that that which we worship cannot be perceived by all the human beings that have ever lived and ever will live together. They don't have enough brain power to see Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And so, don't strain yourself trying to see him. You would be better off straining yourself trying to see the wind, and you'll never see it. You'll say, I see it coming. You see it. That's not the wind. That's the dust that's being carried by it. Because the wind is not within the human perception. And I think that, inshallah, we want to talk today in the brief time that we have. We want to talk today about human perception. And we'll start off in this discussion today, in this khutbah, by referring you to the 90th chapter of the Holy Qur'an called Al-Balad, the city. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the Most High, he says, I do call to witness this city. And and Allah is talking to the prophet, praise be upon him. He says, and you are a free man of the city, and you are of the parent and child. Verily, we have created man into toil and struggle. He should not think that none have power over him. And he may say with a boast, I have wasted much wealth in abundance. Think he not that none can behold him? Have we not made for him a pair of eyes, and a tongue, and a pair of lips, and show him the two highways? But he has made no haste on the path that is steep. And what will explain to you the path that is steep? It's freeing the slave, or giving food and a day of hunger to the orphan who has a tie to you. or to the person who has no tie to you but is in need, then will he be of those who believe. This is the criterion that Allah has given us for the believer. And enjoy patience and self-restraint, and enjoy deeds of kindness and compassion. Such are the companions of the right man. But those who reject our signs, they are the companions of the left hand. And on them will be fire all around them. Surely Allah the Mighty speaks the truth. So that's the 90th chapter of the Quran. And it's talking about Balad, the city. And we know that the city is something that represents, symbolize life, that you are to be in a city, you have to have structure, you have to be organized, you have to have order. And we know that we're not the only ones that live in cities, right? You know, y'all have seen on TV, maybe you didn't quit before one, but you can buy one on anthills. And you can see the ants have a city. And the bees have a city. And what makes this city function is that they have order. They have leadership. They have direction. People aren't in there doing as they please. Everybody is following the pattern of organized life so that the city may progress. And so, Allah on Most High has given us a clear, Allah on Most High has given to us, out of His mercy for us, out of His generosity towards us, He has given us two highways. One that leads to the city, and one that leads to the hellfire. And the one that leads to the city, oh, that high, that way is steep. And Allah has also given to us two eyes. But We have two eyes, but we have one vision. We have one vision. And so how is it possible that you have two eyes and the eyes are not on top of each other? The eyes are set apart. And they're set apart in such a way because each eye has approximately 46 degrees of perspective, but yet they're not 46 degrees apart. So what happens in your eyes is that the vision of the left and the right, they overlap. And they overlap, and so what you have is you have a need for a synthesis. Can they have one vision from two different eyes, and they're seeing things from each eye sees from what? A different, somewhat unique perspective. And you can survive with one eye. You know, we asked Blackbeard, what was his name? He asked him. And he was successful. He was successful. Did he call himself the Candyman? But what do you get with two eyes? What do you get with two eyes that you don't get with one? Death. Death. Death of vision. So what is death of vision? It is comprehensive perspective. You get relief. You know what relief is? That which is not on the same plane. You're able to see deeper. And you're able to understand prominence. What's prominence? Some things are prominent, and some things are less prominent. The things that are prominent, what is the most prominent thing? La ilaha illallah. The most prominent is another term for important. So when you have two eyes, you're able to better understand and better to conclude and to discern and to determine your priorities in life. And so with the two eyes, you can say, I worship none but Allah the Most High. Even though I have an eye to see the shaitan, and I have an eye to see the divine order of Allah. But from seeing these three things, I have seen relief, and I've seen prominence, and I also have gained some depth. Where? In my soul. And that gives me the ability to make decisions so that I can go into and ballot. I can enter the city now. And I can enter the city, how? As a man who is free. And a free person is a person with rights and responsibilities. Someone who is in a position. If he's seeing things properly, or if he has a proper perspective on things, he is going to assist the slave, free the slave, and feed the poor, the miskin and the fukara, the people man who are without means. He's gonna come to them, and he's gonna share of his. He's not gonna take a $5 bill and light his stogie. Well, you're hungry, and he can stick the $5 bill, lit the stove up, and throw the $5 bill away, the ashes, and boast that he never uses anything left of the fire. So this is what Allah has told us in this very short sura, is that we have to have the proper perspective to be civilized and to be the companions of the right hand, the believers, to be able to come into civilized relationship with one another. Perspective. And so now, what is the problem in Nice, France? The problem in Nice, when this person, they say, a Tunisian, has killed 88 people and wounded some others. The problem in these is the problem of perspective. The French have a perspective that it's okay to run down and denigrate Islam, to present the Prophet as a woman, as a homosexual, as a negative thing, and that's called freedom of speech. Now you do the same thing to the president of France, and they'll arrest you for sedition. So their behavior is based on an absence of perspective. And as we said, we have two eyes. And those two eyes give us one vision, but that one vision is not really an accurate vision. It represents a compromise. The eyes, the mind takes the information from the two eyes, and it comes up with its own perspective of what's out there. By analyzing this data, it's able to make some understandings, and it gets some depth. It gets a sense of the dimensions. Because with one eye, you only see two dimensions. But with the third, with the second eye, you receive the third dimension, which we call death, or relief, or prominence, depending on how you see it. And the people who think that it is justifiable to murder innocent people in the name of Islam, they have a problem with their perspective. You are not advancing the mission of Muhammad the Prophet, the prayer of peace be upon him, or the interest of Muslims by hurting innocent people. You are advancing the program of Shaitan. And you're dividing people. You're trying to get Donald Trump elected. So we have to have, and as Muslims, we have to have a perspective. So Allah says, I have given you two eyes. So one eye allows me to look at things based on how Muslims see things, how we understand it, how we feel about things. I'm sure that the Muslims in France feel oppressed. The sisters can't wear their hair covering. The men are mistreated. I understand. I have not lived in France, but I understand that, you know, it's difficult for people who are from North Africa or who look like they're Middle Eastern, to get good jobs, education. They live in the undesirable parts of the city. They get the undesirable jobs. And that gives you, that treatment gives you a perspective. But you have to use the other eye sometimes to come up with a composite vision and look at the point of view of the French, the Caucasian French. All their lives, they've been told that the Caucasian French are the best mothers. They get the best language. They get the best food. They have the best sensibility. They have all these ideas of the superiority of the Caucasian French. Not the Caucasian British. Not the Germans. God knows not the Polacks. But the French, they are burning with their perception of their superiority. And so you have to understand, when they mistreat you, they're buried with the improper perception. So we have to look at them as people who are mentally ill, buried by their obsession with their superiority. And we had that problem in America. We don't have that problem now for the most part. Caucasians don't walk around like that. They walk around with sometimes a superior idea, superior culture, superior money, and superior things, but they don't really think that they're superior in their human essence anymore. So we have to see the burden of the French, and we have to help them work themselves out of this idea that they're superior by virtue of their having been born. Not based on their achievement, just on being Caucasian and French and speaking the French language. So we look at, we see their problem. We see the problem that we have. When you are discriminated against, that has an impact on your thinking, on your psychology. You have post-traumatic stress from being the victim of this
discrimination and in bigotry. Even the homosexuals, the reason why they fight so hard to promote themselves is because they feel that homosexuals discriminate against them. And so all these perspectives are there. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is telling us that we have to be balanced in our perception so we can deal with the situation in a way that is civilized. And that we have to always take, according to the surah that we read, we have to take the high road. The road that Allah has preferred, that the road that Allah has blessed, which means for us that we can't give in to emotionalism. We can't go out shooting people, killing people, denigrating people, even when they are behavior is wrongly guided. If they come against us to hurt us, we have the right to defend ourselves. Because they don't like us, because they ridicule us, because they insult our prophet, because they see no value in Islam, they see no value in your being African, you're being from the North Africa, you're being from the Turkey, or Yugoslavia, or the United Kingdom. We can't cause pillage, act like the vandals. We have to be the people who are going to free the slave and feed the hungry and respect the tithe between us and our brethren and our neighbors. This is the life that Allah has carved out for the believers. This is the valley. This is the city. This is the human. This is what they call the social contract that Allah the Most High wants us to enter into so that we can live together respecting people. Even though they don't believe as we believe, that if they're willing to respect us, that we have to be respectful of them, and when they make mistakes, and how they deal with us, then we have to respond in an appropriate manner. So they say, well, France is over there killing Muslims in Syria and doing these other things. But those people that were in these, they hadn't done that. That was no justification for hurting those people. And it is not within the perspective that we want you to get from. And maybe you have 2 eyes, maybe you have 10 eyes. But whatever perspective you have, there's no justification in Islam for the murder of innocent people. And so, the shaitan, the enemy to the human being, he's the enemy to the Jews, the Christians, and the Muslims, and to all of the good people. Because what he wants is we want us to hate one another, and we want us to lash out against one another. And he also wants us to take on this idea, this perspective, that racism in the world is on the rise. But if you're really looking carefully, racism in the world is on the decline. It is the perspective of the media, the tool of Shaitan, to whip us up into frenzy so that they can better exploit us. But Allah the Most High has told us that we're to take on the perspective that the believers will be successful. And that all things are in the hands of Allah, and that in time, the good and the good people are going to come out on top. So if we have that perspective, we just fly off the handle and go out, strap a bomb to ourselves, and go to some nursery and blow up some people. We want to be around to see the will of Allah being manifest. We want to be around to see some of the babies are going to grow up and say, La ilaha illallah Muhammad Rasulullah. So we have to have faith. We want to be the companions on the right side. We want to be the people of the ballot. We don't want to be the people who are in the who refuse to come into the city, who refuse to live under order, to accept to be disciplined, to worship Allah alone. Those are the ones in the desert. But we have accepted the civilized life that Allah has chartered for the human being. And we have accepted that our vision will be one that is balanced, that looks at the right and looks at the left and comes up with a just decision. That no one will take us out of our human condition. You can't tell me something in this Quran and give me the following that takes me out of my human intelligence. It takes me out of my own sense of what's right and what's wrong. I'm looking at this Quran and I'm weighing it with my perspective. Based on what Allah guided me to before I got to this Quran. And this is what's holding us back, dear believers. This is why Jum'ah is so important. That we have to come here after having 6 days of drinking from the font of the shaitan, the media, the culture war, all of this, we have to come in here and get some relief. Be free from the shadows of this ungodly guidance. That's trying to convince us. All hope is lost. If the Christians are going to kill us all, the Jews are going to kill us. They're trying to survive. They're burdened. It's a burden. To believe that everybody's going to hell except the people in your congregation on this block. All other Baptists are going to hell. But the ones who follow this brother, we don't want the ones going to hell. The Jehovah's Witnesses said they're better hell for them. The Jews said they're better hell for them. The Muslims said they're better hell for them. That's a burden. So if you believe you have a Muslim, everybody's going to hell because they haven't accepted Muhammad, which means you're going to send Prophet Abraham to hell. He accepts Muhammad. Moses didn't accept Muhammad. Jesus didn't accept Muhammad. All going to hell. So if you have that perspective, you're looking with one eye in the dark, and you got glaucoma, and you have that perspective, it's easy to go ahead and kill somebody's baby. Because you're blind in your vision. But if you have that perspective, the Allah alone is weighing the value of your iman. And He is the determiner that we're going to say to them, the people, you wait and we'll wait and let Allah decide who is right. Then we can't kill them because we may be killing them. We may be the ones who should go to hell and kill the ones that should go into the Jannah. And so, the relief today, dear believers, is that we, if we are looking into this Quran and we have some amount of human decency, we should be able to find ourselves. And then we come to the Jum'ah, the Salat of Jum'ah, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has made it mandatory for the men to come to Jum'ah. And if we come here, we should come to some place where we're getting a human perspective, an intelligent perspective, balanced. You can't just look at this thing based on the Muslim jihad. We have to consider the perspective of the Jews and the Christians. And the other people, the Biskini and the Fukura. Maybe they look at it from the hypocrites. The hypocrites are bird. They don't know who to kiss up to in a given moment. They're burned by that. And so, let us lead by example. Let us be the people of the light. Let us be the people who are trying to free the burden, take the burden off of the French. Take the burden off the British. Take the burden off the jingoism of the Yankee, who said, I'm going to shock and awe them. Y'all remember that? Remember shocking awe? President Bush said, we're going to Iraq. We'll be back in a couple of days. When we get off the boat, them stand niggas are going to lay down and make obeisance to me. So this was the idea of the I'm God. No, Allah said, you're not the Elah. You're going to be shocked and awe. And we're still in shock. And we're still in awe. Don't know what happened. And this is Allah trying to humble us, to help us gain what? Gain depth of vision. See this thing the way it is. Stop trying to think you control everything, that you're the boss of everything. This world is, they try to control this world through the power of the wind. You know, this is a window, right? This is a window. And a window is what? It's a made-up word. It means a door for the wind. Window. Wind. Door. We're not supposed to come in. The air is supposed to come in. And then they, if you go to the religious house, they always have one that's a stain. You know something's stained. When you get a stain on something, you're supposed to do what? Well, clean it up. So, they in religion are trying to control us and manipulate us through emotionalism, through the wind. And not only do we have the wind, but it is a corrupt wind, because it's stained. But we have to resist the tendency to give ourselves over to death to the infidel. You may be talking about yourself. So, believers, we want to be the people of the highest character of civilized behavior on the planet Earth. We want to deal with people with using the same methodology as Muhammad ibn Abdullah. Y'all know who that is?
My son.
Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Alhamdulillah, Rabbil Alameen. Wa salatu wa salamu ala Sayyidina Muhammad Rasulullah Kareem. I like that. The Quran is full of raps. But it has power. More, even more power than who's Beyonce telling me? Jay-Z? The Quran is more powerful even than his lyrics. Now, Allah says in this Quran, this day I have completed my favor upon you and perfected for you your way of life, your deen. And that Satan has given up hope of taking you from this, that he can only get you into small things. So if you believe that, then don't worry.
Is under control.
Yep.
Yes, sir. Thank you, John.
We got it. This day, they don't want me to say this. Not us here.
I'm talking about who else?
We're not worried about anybody else. We ain't worried about nobody else.
Jay-Z wants it. He wants to spend all the money. Him and what's the other dude? Kanye. He's hot though, man. He's hot like Italian pepper. You see, he got a hot breath. I understand that they get divorced, right?
See, but I can't read the Quran, I read the People magazine.
Alright, now. So, how many of y'all believe that Allah is God?
I believe that.
So why are you worried about these people? Look, I don't care what they say about Muhammad the Prophet. I know him. You can come to me and tell me my mother is this, my mother. I know my mother. They ain't gonna affect me. Now you give me the bad boy, I'm gonna kill you. But that's not the best of me. You cannot represent my mother to me. And you cannot represent the Prophet to the world. You can't raise the Prophet up. He's already too high over you. You got to try to bring him down. It's almost making him rise higher.
That's right.
What is the most popular name in the whole world?
Muhammad.
Now, they told you it was John. But you go back and Google it. The most popular name in the whole world is not Jesus. And he had no sons.
That's a lie.
No sons. But all the men, the majority of the men in the world support him. Okay, how many wives do you have? All the women want to marry him. That know anything about a man. Why? He was the man's man and he was the woman's man. So, let's not be shook about the people who say, we're not trying to compare the Prophet Muhammad to Jesus, the Word of God. That's not our respect. Their roles were different. Jesus, peace be upon him, he came to bring us into life. He came as a baby. He came as a quickening spirit to bring us into the life. Muhammad came to bring us into civilization. See, you all Christians, you be saying hallelujah, amen, you be jumping up. But you all been told you can't move around for the hellfire. Who told you that? Now, we don't want the women coming here now. Close the window. The window. We think, every day we have to thank Imam Muhammad for guiding us to this understanding of this. Maybe. But we here in America, we're going to bring out the good sense of this Quran, and we're going to be an example. And so, if Newt Gingrich come to me and say, "Look, do you follow the Sharia?" We have to say, yeah, we follow the way. We built the ship, we picked the cotton, we suckled you, and now you're gonna come in and question me? So we're not concerned about you being sending us back to Africa. That'd be the worst thing they could do, send us back to Africa with what we got. Because then Africa, if we apply this Quran, in Liberia, or Nigeria, or Ivory Coast, or Senegal, we would have something to compete with America with. Because we have the superior knowledge. But we cannot allow someone to give us the world perspective on what is required of us as Muslims. Allah is not requiring us to be crazy-minded, to be desperate. We have to be patient. Allah says here that we have to be patient. Now, the one who gives the food in the time of privation to the orphan, who claims your relationship, or to the indigent, will be of those who believe and who enjoy patience and self-restraint and deeds of kindness and compassion. Such are the companions of the right hand. So the answer of how we're going to advance this community is in the Quran. But you have got to have two eyes. Don't just look at it from the point of view of the Muslims. Look at the point of view of those who are not, who are feeding off of something different, who are feeding off the idea that the chosen people are the Jews. I'm telling you, if you believe as a Christian that the Jews are superior to you, you are oppressed. And it's easy to give yourself into drinking and all sorts of things. You try to follow Christ, but you know you never measure up because you are not a Jew. Well, this Quran frees us of that burden. But we have to understand that burden is out there on our brothers and sisters. But even with that burden, I see in the Christian the light of God, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, in them, in their goodness, in their kindness, in their faithfulness. I don't even want to go down Route 193 because I have to go by the First Baptist Church of Union Island, and I know I can't get through there because there's so many people coming to worship. They got to have the police force directing the traffic. But look at how beautiful a sign of their faith is that. So we are blessed, dear believers, to be in a place where the valley exists, where the poor are being fed, where the slaves are being free, and where patience, self-restraint, and deeds of kindness are prevalent. So let us not give in to despair or another Muslim tragedy. For any tragedy that the media is blasting out, there are Muslims who are providing food throughout the world. There are Muslims that are doing things they will never be reported. The things that the Muslims are doing to advance society, you're not going to hear about them. But the Saudis are providing millions and millions all over the Islamic world. Muslims are helping the poor and the oppressed. Here in America, we have been for the last almost 80 years, we have been in this community, have been calling out for justice, have been calling out for fairness, and for the worship of Allah. And we are a community of people who are just out of slavery, who are people of very limited means. And yet we have been in America calling to faith, calling American people to faith, accepting as our brother and sister the people who once enslaved us and spit on us and tried to destroy us. So the people of faith are on the rise, and the prospect for the establishment of the gospel of the society, the prospect are very healthy. If we can just keep a positive perspective on the future, and you tell our children that don't get the perspective that the Muslims are people who like to kill and murder. That if we were to look over time, 10 times as many Muslims have been killed by the Christians and the Jews than the Christians and the Jews that have been killed by the Muslims. But that Islam is an ideology, and that Islam is an ideology for peace and tolerance and fairness and respect for women and for civilization. And that, prior to the coming of the Holy Qur'an and Muhammad the Prophet, the world had become dark and dead. And it was the coming of the Qur'an that brought about the Renaissance, that brought about the hospitals and the universities, that brought about government, education, science, all that. So don't let the window take you off. Let us be committed to the path that is seen. Let us be committed to establishing the God-conscious society where we can live beside the Christians and the Jews and the non-believers, and establish the right of us to grow, and we will become the foremost. We will become the primary community, calling the people that is right, rejecting what is wrong, and unafraid of the unfair criticism of the people who don't have faith. We ask Allah to forgive us our sins, guide us nearer, increase us in faith, and make us those who are giving ourselves to deeds of kindness, to self-restraint, and bless us to trust that His way will prevail in time. Thank you.
Allahu Akbar.
And so, let us take our attention to making the congregational worship of death.
Allahu Akbar!
Alhamdulillah, Rabbil Alameen.
وَقَالَ الَّذِينَ عَمِلُوا الصَّالِحَاتِ لَنُدْخِلَنَّهُمْ جَنَّاتٍ تَجْرِي مِنْ تَحْتِهَا الْأَنْهَارُ Thank you.